Okay, I'd like to call the meeting to order. This is going to be the first meeting of Sustainable Groundwater Management, TSA. And this is the advisory committee to the East Acton TSA. So the time is 3:07. So I just want to cover just some housekeeping things. I passed around the sign-in sheet. It's organized by first name. You know, look, see if you can find your name, make sure your contact information is correct. I did an email blast to organize this meeting, so I didn't get any non-deliverables based on the email addresses, but if you see someone you know on the list that maybe didn't provide an email address or something that you feel like should have been part of this meeting, definitely feel free to edit that. So that's good.
Go ahead.
I know one thing I wanted to talk about was the timing of this meeting. I know this one is occurring during the day. I am typically the Acton Town Council meets in the evenings. This is just initially just to get the meeting committee started. And does anybody have any preferred time as far as when these meetings should be held for, you know, more involvement from the various interested parties?
Have you gotten any feedback from people who were invited as to RSVP or?
A couple people said they were not available, they were out of town, and one person just requested that they be held in the evenings. So
that's
I
probably better.
So, you know, so what
I
time
really
in the evenings to be
in the evening is better, but not necessarily in conjunction with the town council meeting, because we already have a full plate of stuff to cover. So
so on the next meeting, potentially maybe a 6 p.m. start time for this committee would be a reasonable start time for everyone to get off work and make it in.
Oh, 7 p.m.
Make it at
7:30.
Okay, so.
It depends, you know, I can't speak correctly.
Right now, everyone's picking up their kids after school. The people who aren't working, they're busy with that. And then the next thing is if they're commuting from somewhere, they're going to be sitting in traffic till usually at least 7 o'clock to get here.
Okay.
So
so maybe 7. Just
7
to
7.
On time with the
7 sounds good to me, too.
Thank you for looking into that. I appreciate it.
Yes.
It's not your normal hour. So.
Yeah, the 1 hour thing is getting started. You know, so you have to start somewhere and from here and make adjustments.
Well, I appreciate it.
And as far as location, does the library work well for everyone?
Yes.
Until this meeting? Because I know sometimes we've met at the community center. Yeah. I'm not sure that's helping, but either place would work for me, but this is more suited for the group. One other thing I want to bring up, I do have a webpage established for Sustainable Groundwater Management, and if you've got the emails and the agenda, there's a link on there to our Waterworks page. And you all should have my email address, so if there's any information that you feel is not present or easily accessible on the website, that's the easiest way to keep the group informed. This effort. So if you have any comments or anything, just send them to me. I can work with our webmaster to provide the updates and, you know, provide the information that is of most interest for you regarding the GSA. And one thing the librarian told me, the restroom is unlocked around the corner just in case anyone wants to get up and leave the meeting.
But you can't get back in.
So just knock on the door.
I thought it was intentional.
So at this point, is there any public comments? I have a list of agenda items. Is there anything that any individuals here want to bring up at this point?
I was just wondering, how often do you plan on holding meetings?
I think the purpose of this meeting should precede the next meeting of the board of directors.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, one of the agenda items below, it discusses the basic boundary modification process. So I don't see the board taking any immediate action, through the summer. But I would say maybe a couple more times this year, if that makes sense. Or
we're not talking quarterly or monthly.
No, I don't think there's things won't happen that quickly with sustainable groundwater management. But if there's an issue that comes up, the purpose of the advisory committee is to advise the board of directors or the GSA. So any decisions the board will be making, the advisory committee should have a preview of those actions or those agenda items that the board may take action on. So any other comments?
Yes. Yeah, I don't know if I should do it now or wait till the meeting's over. Are we going to do public comments after the when you're done?
If you want to make time, and the meeting will make time for it.
Whatever.
Okay.
Okay, I'll do it real quick. I'm just a Acton resident. I'm here to on behalf of all the water haulers and to support them, because if it wasn't for them, we'd be gone. Our well went dry 15 years ago, and without them, we can't live here. And I just want to bring up a couple of points. First of all, thank all of them. Without you, Acton, Agua Dulce would be ghost towns. Okay, I want you guys to understand just how important they are to our community. They are the backbone and the lifeblood of these communities. There are a lot of people out there whose wells are dry, who do not produce, that couldn't be here without them. I want you guys to really understand that. And I also want you to understand what they have sacrificed and what they have lost because of their profession. This is a very dangerous, very stressful profession. They've lost family members and loved ones because of it. And I don't think it's fair that the county of LA should be punishing them anymore. I think they've been through enough. I really do. This is wrong. And I'm going to repeat myself from the last meeting. Why don't you guys start taking the damn millions of dollars away from the high-speed rail and put it into some kind of fund to help the water haulers? Why should they pay out of pocket for all this? Why? Why are you punishing them? Take this wasted money and put it to good use. You know, we don't need a high-speed rail. It doesn't put water in my house or, in anybody's house. And that's basically what I want to say. I'm here to support them 110%. And I want the county to understand just how important they are to all of us. All of us. And don't punish them. Don't make them pay for more money out of their pocket that they shouldn't be paying for. It's wrong.
Thank you.
There, got it off my chest. I may have more to say, but right now that's basically what I wanted to bring to your attention. Just how important they are to us.
Understood.
Okay.
Something I did skip over, I didn't do introductions. So my name is Kirk Allen. I work with LA County Department of Public Works. I'm the Water Resource Manager for the LA County Public Works Districts. And I'm here as a member of the Advisory Committee.
Good afternoon. My name is Mitch Glazer. I'm an Assistant Administrator with the Los Angeles County Department of Regional Planning. I'm a member of the GSA Board and I'm here for the Advisory Committee.
Jack here with say where we're at, sort.
Bill Lundy, resident and water hauler.
Lynn Bennett, 35-year resident.
Amber Diane, 30-year resident and active water.
Matt Knutson, I'm with Antelope Valley East Current Water Agency. John Joyce, Acton Abel Dulce News.
Rob Peters, Acton Town Council and Acton resident.
Ruthie Brock, Acton Town Council, 25-year resident.
Russ Fox, Acton Town Council.
Lillian Smith, Country Journal, I'm resident in the area for over 30 years.
Thank you very much, everyone. So moving on into the general agenda items, this being our first meeting, we don't have any minutes to adopt. So I'll just move on to 2.2 and discuss the status of the basin boundary modification process and the new schedule that EWR has put in as opposed. The initial notification for boundary modifications were submitted on November 14th. That was after our last meeting of the board of directors. So it was accepted by the state. And that was just the initial notification to explore a basin boundary modification for the East Acton coverage area. So the next timeline, or the next critical point is submitting the required information for the modification. Previously, it was at the end of March. They have pushed that back 3 months now till June 30th, 2018.
That's a deadline, sir?
Yes, that is the window.
So do we work from deadlines, or do we do it quickly to get an answer quickly?
No, after June 30th, there's a 30-day public comment period. So once the state has collected all the boundary modifications during this open window, there's a 30-day window to review the submitted modification request.
Do you think they extended the window because they expect an avalanche of applications, or do you have any feelings for why they extended the time frame to submit?
I think the process takes time, but I don't
know. To prepare the applications.
Right. So, you know, to do research and provide a more complete submittal, research and so forth, I think it was more to extend it out. So, but I mean, that's my general assumption.
Kurt, before we move on, what does a 30-day public comment period look like? Does that mean community meetings, or what, advisory committee meetings, or board meetings, or what is that?
So the 30-day comment period is when the State Department of Water Resources posts the proposed boundary modifications on, you know, their website, their portal, for this modification process. And if anyone has any comments or questions, I think that's just the due process.
Well, is it something where we should support what has been submitted, or?
I think that would certainly help. I mean,
are many letters.
Well, that's the question. What's the best way to support this application to DWR? Do they care? People write letters of support, or is it a purely technical issue, or?
There are online polls. Is there?
Obviously, we want this to go through, but we don't want to waste time. We also don't want to supply information that's going to just irritate them, and then they'll just reject it because they're petulant or something. I don't know.
So no, I don't have an idea of how they'll interpret, you know, the support. But I think in the submittal process, any letter that the advisory committee were going to prepare and have part of the submittal process, it will show how the GSA has engaged with the community, deciding on, hey, here's the next step we're taking in this boundary modification process, and here's a letter of support. I think that all shows that we've reached out to the community and all interested parties within the GSA. So if, you know, there's any opposition, that would be the time period that somebody could object to it. But I think the letter of support is very positive. And so.
Is the board going to produce whatever is submitted to the town council, to the Country Journal, to the Acton Abel Dulce News, so that the community knows exactly what was submitted in the boundary modification?
Yes, I will be submitting the information to the state. So I have access to the online portal, and the online portal has public views from
So you'll tell us when you submitted it and how we can get at it.
Yes. So any comments, anything you want to, to relay, it would be through me.
Assuming there'll be lots of letters for a lot of other different things, should they be addressed with a specific project number on them? Should they have a specific attention so that it gets to the right people for the right meeting, for the right project? Versus, you know, I'm sure you guys get tons of mail for many things and for things to get lost, versus someone has to open and read everything and then find out where it goes, versus if it's on the envelope, they can go, oh, all of these go to here, and then you'll get them for those reasons.
Yeah, my mailing address, I have business cards here. If you want to send me like a snail mail on any email, you can just email it to me. It's easier for me to.
Okay.
The state's already gone through this process at least once, depending on, they assign a file number or an application number, and you would reference that.
That's what trying to get at.
He's asking about the mechanism for submitting comments during the comment period to the state.
Yes.
Okay.
So if the town council wants to say, for example, submit its own letter, independent of the letter that this advisory committee would submit through you, does that make sense?
Yeah, so I mean, if that's the circumstance, then the state will have some sort of contact information for that. So.
What I'm actually interested in.
And I can relay that information.
That would be great, because that would be what you need.
Yeah.
But what I am more interested in learning, rather than what we should say to support this, is finding out from you, both of you, what you have heard in the halls in which you work that are potential arguments that would sink this ship, so that in our responses to the state, we can address those concerns. So for example, if somebody in somebody in the health department has expressed concern about getting us out of the Avent Animal Valley Basin, because that will give the county less control over groundwater here, because we'll be reprioritized potentially to very low. If those concerns have been echoed in the hallways in which you generally work, I would like us to hear about it, not know who it is, but know the content of the concerns so that we would have an opportunity to try to address them. Maybe you can perceive it that way. I know things have been said because I've heard them actually. So the more we know about the opposition to this application, it seems the better off we are to be able to submit comments that address any concerns. Am I making sense?
Yes.
So I would appreciate if you have your ear to the ground. Say, oh, well, we understand that some entities in the county might be concerned, or not even county, it might be,
State.
Center for Biological Diversity, or Sierra Club, or whatever. We've heard this, or if you get comments from these agencies, can you distribute them to us, or will you make us go through the Public Records Act request process, or, so we're aware of whether or not, you're the lightning rod for comments that people are going to be submitting, what those comments may be. Does that make sense? I don't know what.
Yeah,
I'm asking it properly.
Yeah, I think, that would, it would be good to have another committee meeting, to discuss any of that.
Okay, that would be great.
At that point, we'll have something to
I can't
discuss.
Ask for more than that. That would be terrific.
Can you just ask a procedural thing? When you say that things will be posted on the portal, does that mean that we will have to constantly check in the portal, or are you going to actually send it out email alerts? Anything happens.
It's easy for me to send out an email blast.
Right,
so that's something that's easy to stay engaged. Things can be provided on the webpage, and that way everyone is relatively informed. At least get an email. And then, with the town council,
but actually,
yeah, up there.
Yeah.
Very helpful.
At those meetings. That seems to be an efficient way to communicate.
Better than having to constantly go on to the board and see if there's any changes.
No, that's understood.
Okay, thank you.
So I think I was discussing the 30-day public comment period. It opens July 1st and will close at the end of the month. And then sometime in the fall, DDFR will release the draft modifications. And the final basin boundary modifications are released potentially late fall, winter of this year. So, and the last bullet I would like to bring everyone's attention to is, the basin priority reassessment begins at that point.
Can we back up a step, Kirk? Mm-hmm. What's the difference between the draft basin boundary modification released and final basin boundary modification released?
Potentially there's something the state is handling that they proposed.
I think the thing we were low priority in fall, and then in early 2019, we would be told we're not low priority.
You won't know the priority at the end of 2018.
It's just whether or not they agree to modify the basin and take us out of Antelope Valley.
Okay.
So, and make our own basin.
Yeah, so this is just merely, I got a handout. I'll just split the stack and send it both directions. But this is also on our website. And it shows that there's just one little, right at the mouth of Soledad Canyon, as you head up the 14. That will be the only, that will be the boundary modification for the East Acton service area.
Yes, can I recommend you actually, in your submittal, you show it on a drainage line, because it's, what it is the dividing line is the drainage, right? Because we were in a...
The dividing line is the adjudication boundary.
We're making a basin argument, though. Would there be the drainage basin?
The hydrologic boundary.
Right.
Or the Santa Clara watershed.
Yes.
So that can accompany the...
Yeah, so it's not going to be straight line. It's I mean, shown as a straight line, but it's really a ridge line, right?
That will have to be discussed with the state. Because you wouldn't want to leave them here unmanaged.
Right, but you also wouldn't want to have a person who's in the Santa Clara River Basin be still in Antelope Valley. I mean, that doesn't make any sense, but if we're going to make a hydrogeologic argument, it needs to sort of be all the way. That's just my opinion. I don't know what else to say, but straight lines make me nervous is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, I think this is just the coverage within the area. So that's something that I think takes time when the state does these boundary assessments. And is it a jurisdictional boundary or is it a scientific boundary based on hydrology?
Well, you would still have you have jurisdiction on both sides of this red line, right? County, because it's all unincorporated. So
potentially, well, it's the adjudication portion does not require a GSA,
right?
But if you leave a sliver or some piece of ground that isn't managed, the state will come in. I don't know how they would handle it.
I have a question.
This
and this is like pertaining to our CUP. We were given through 2018 before our CUP, we had to do the hydrogeologic report or anything like that to see where we're at. But if we're not going to know until 2019 where we're at on it, how is that going to affect our CUP and our? Because at this point, you guys have stopped us from moving forward on it until we find out where we're, where our basin is now going to be. So How does that affect us going into 2019, still not knowing?
Sure. Well, and this is item 2.4 on the agenda, because after the last GSA board meeting, the town council sent us a letter, and one of the things that they asked was clarification on how the CUPs would be handled, since that had come up at the meeting. So since the timeline has extended out to early 2019, we've extended that time frame as well for the CUPs.
So will we get something in writing on that for the CUP? Because I haven't received anything on that.
Sure. I was actually going to, I brought some extra copies of the letter. I know the town council received it just last week.
We pushed it out to the papers. So we'll look for it.
But I brought copies too, sure. And I'll, like I said, maybe I'll wait till 2.4 and then I'll pass these out and we can talk some more if there's more questions about it.
Okay.
And Kurt, can you tell me where that red line is?
So I have another handout. This kind of has a little bit of kind of a splitting.
Oh god, I see the deal. Looks like it's color. I see what he's saying now. This is like way over. This is actually part of the ballot. We're gonna reject it. Probably okay, but because we want you to marry up to the adjudicated boundary, you have to grab this part, and since it's not hydrologically reasonable to grab this part, we reject your entire application. If you're having discussions with the state, I would really like you to have that discussion right now, because if it's going to cause the application to be kicked to the curb, because it's scientifically inaccurate, then we need to discuss maybe making at least another basin squeezed between Acton's drainage. Because the community of Acton is defined by that drainage boundary. So there's not a drop of water, there's not a portion of Acton that isn't part of the Santa Clara River shed. So, you know, there might be a small interstitial space that drains the Antelope Valley. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. That's worrisome for me.
Yeah, I know that's everything. That's the crux in the situation. You know, does the state determine the connection? You know, if you've seen the profiles as you know, you're uphill to the point of the divide, and it's downhill to the hill divide. So, you know, hopefully there's some, we'll have that discussion as we pursue the basic.
constraint, like Steve said, we want you to marry up with the educated boundary, because then...
Well, there's two types of boundary modifications. It can be jurisdictional, and it can be scientific, or it can be a hybrid of both. So, you know, as this process is submitted, it's, that's the diagram that they have for these basic boundary modification decision process as it goes along. There's those two different types of requests.
Okay, but I don't think a jurisdictional boundary decision results in reprioritization. Maybe I'm mistaken. I thought it was only the actual boundary adjustment modification that results in reprioritization, but I could be wrong. I, you know,
no, I haven't.
Okay, I could be mistaken. Suddenly I'm very nervous, that's what I'm trying to say.
I know, there were some basin boundary modifications that were submitted in 2016, and they still haven't been reprioritized. So the state does take a long time to go through the reprioritize. Hopefully, they streamline that evaluation process with their hydrogeologists, get through, you know, the data, the request, and, you know, see that determination made, and they're hoping that it's quicker. But I've asked that question about when they'll provide that priority reassessment, and I think they're very, very vague on, you know, that timeline.
I'm not worried about that so much as getting the whole thing kicked, because we didn't, we're making a scientific argument that isn't, doesn't go the whole way for the rest of the rest. Anyway.
That would be a technical glitch, I think, the process, but you make a good point, and I'll make sure to ask those questions.
Even if they can say, hey, you know what, we'll shine it on, then okay. And
if you have any other, I know we're having a meeting today discussing some of these issues, but if you have any other questions that come up after this and you want to bring to my attention, because I will be submitting for this boundary modification, please submit. This is our effort. This is an advisory committee. This is a local control groundwater basin. We want to be together, you know, and approach this in a logical and, you know, hopefully straightforward process to, you know, keep things separated.
Could you share with us when you have that discussion with the state, what their impressions might have been? Do you mind when you at that time? So I'm just sending out an email last saying, oh, the state's not worried about it, it'll be fine. So Jack, you can get to sleep. Because I'm going to be up. This is going to make me very nervous for a while, so.
I mean, I think the state would have to have a reasonable approach to it. You know,
it is the state we're talking about.
Yeah,
so.
The state department.
A reasonable approach is always.
So, you know, I have good faith in the state and we'll, you know, look at our situation. So, okay, that covers 2.2. The next item, 2.3, you know, I put on here to kind of discuss the organizational structure. The advisory committee does not have a vote on the GSA board. I think at the point here, you know, we're trying to pursue a basin boundary modification. We're not pursuing a groundwater sustainability plan at this point until we have that determination from the state. So, you know, I don't think there's anything that we can sway a vote on at this point, you know, for the board to act on. I think it's pretty clear what the board has made up the directions on at the last meeting to pursue the modification process. But if in the event that it's not clear a low priority and we're required to develop a sustainability plan, you know, I feel like the advisory committee, you know, should have a stronger voice in the decisions that go into how a GSP is developed and managed, you know, in the future. And we're talking 5, 10, 15 years in the future. And we want to make sure that the community and all, you know, groundwater users within the watershed, within the GSA boundary are represented. I know we have some water haulers here, some people on public water systems, and maybe a few.
Some farmers.
Some farmers, essentially. So, I would like everyone to think about who should be at this advisory committee and make sure that their interests are represented. I mean, I think purposes, this group is to basically line out who we should have here at these meetings, or make sure that their, you know, their voices are, you know, as if an event that we have to get a sustainability plan developed. So I don't see us taking any organizational structuring at this point. I think just communication with email and maybe another meeting towards summertime.
I think we're having an unruly mob right now.
I don't think anyone's unruly.
We're not doing a job right yet.
Is ABEC on the board yet or not?
No, ABEC has not been added to the board. And how this process works is, I've had discussions with the state Department of Water Resources last week, and I'm trying to find out if there's other GSAs have modified their legal agreement, their memorandum of agreement, memorandum of understanding MOUs, and so forth, to add another agency. That hasn't occurred at this point. So I'm drafting a language to modify our MOU with an amendment to bring ABEC on, you know, as a voting member, as a party to the GSA.
Thank you very much.
So again, that's the steps we're trying to figure this out. The state is not very helpful. And, you know, because they just don't, it's the code, Sustainable Groundwater Management Act, is silent
right
on how you go about reorganizing, you know, adaptive governance of the GSA within the county, within APEC, to make that merge a new agency to the GSA sound. And we will have to update the state on the notice, the boundaries for APEC, and so forth, that are part of our notice. Will have to all be included and updated. But, you know, we are moving forward with that process.
You haven't heard then, it sounds like county council hasn't gone back and said, well, because the statute's silent on this, we're going to assume that means you can't, which would be wrong. But you haven't heard that. Okay, so that's great. No pushback in the direction that would cause this effort to stumble. So that's
no, great. I mean, you just want to do it right. You know, by adding a new agency, then, you know, in turn, you need all the other GSAs on how we modify ours, brought in new agencies, new governance, adaptive governance, you know, for the GSA. And then, you know, some of the state can use and hopefully that helps other people. So,
blaze the trail.
So as far as the structure, does anyone have any comments about how to potentially organize the various groups? I know I have an interested parties list on the notice for the GSA. I included ABEC as an interested party. The water haulers are also listed as an interested party. I'm not too familiar with the ag, the farmers that are obviously users of groundwater in the basin. I would like to collect and, you know, develop that interested party list a little bit more in depth. So if there's names, in conversation as you have your meetings, I would appreciate, you know, any local information that you could share with me to help build and develop, a more comprehensive list to ensure that, you know, we're representing.
Should people who draw more than X number?
I don't think we're even asking that question. You grow crops. The state does have an online mapping system that does line out a few ag properties within the basin, and they have an orchard or something. But making sure that their interests are represented here, and making sure that they are within the boundaries of the GSA.
I think that at that meeting, that first meeting, there were several that were interested, but they might not have identified themselves as such. We've got vineyards, we've got lilac farms, we've got fruit farms, we've got all of the farms and fields. So, but I don't know if they didn't identify. And several of those people were here. So, what we can do is announce at all the town council meetings that you're an ag interest, the county wants to make sure they reached out adequately to the ag folks, because they probably captured all the water holders. But the legal ones.
Yeah, it's a little, you know, a little shine a little bit of light on that to make sure that, you know, engage fully with areas of the act and just,
I think Jackie's right. I think there were some people here, but we can also brainstorm and make some contacts.
Yeah, just so that they know what's going on. You know, I mean, that idea is that, you know, if we have to pursue a groundwater sustainability plan, you know, this committee, I mentioned earlier, you know, will be the voice of everyone within the GSA.
Well, are you envisioning a limit to the number of people? Because that would inform the discussion as well.
It would be great if there was, you know, potentially a structure where, you know, an ag person was appointed to represent the other ag.
Same way with the water haulers, or?
Potentially. It would make sense. There's no voting, you know, privileges as, you know, part of the advisory committee to the board decisions. But it's just making sure each sector within water use within the basin have some representation at this, at, you know, future meetings. So, it's just a thought, it's an idea. You know, if we do have to pursue the GSP, you know, we will want that voice.
But we're going to work really hard to make that not be where we're going, right?
We will. So there's another comments on the organizational structure at this point. 2.4, I just want to mention that, you know, I was in receipt of the Acton Town Council letter. I'm not sure if everyone here was privileged to that letter, but I know Mitch here and Regional Planning did prepare a response to some questions in that letter. So I don't know if you
want to just got that letter from the last council meeting, and it was just passed by the last council meeting, so nobody had a chance to discuss it or get it on there.
So the primary issue that was raised in the town council letter is one that was raised a little bit earlier in the meeting, and that is how this process might impact the water haulers. And that was one of the major concerns of the board meeting. We heard it again at the beginning of the meeting this afternoon. So I think the town council wanted to get a clarification in writing from regional planning as to what our position on the CUPs are. So what the letter attempted to do was clarify what I shared at the last board meeting, which is that the main thing that we've asked for from the three water haulers is the hydrogeological study. And so since there's some uncertainty as to whether the GSP will move forward and whether we'll have to do our own study as part of the GSA process, we decided to put that request on hold until the state makes its decision. So at the board meeting last year, the time frame hadn't extended out to 2019, so I think I had identified December of this year as sort of the general time frame. Since the state's timeline has pushed out, we've pushed out that same timeline for the water haulers, so that's what this letter mentions, is that we're looking at early 2019, but if the state process continues to delay, then we'll respond in kind. The other thing, though, that we tried to clarify in the letter is with regard to the water haulers, is that if there are other items that are outstanding, we still would like to receive those and continue processing those. So the request for the hydrogeological study, but any other requests that we've made, we'd like to move forward with those, and we did attempt to summarize those. I think for one of the applications, there are no other issues at this time, but for two of the other applications, we're looking for some clearance letters on some other documentation. And so for those applicants, if they're not clear on what else they need to turn in, certainly you can contact me or you can contact Sam Day and we can walk you through that because it's just summarized here. It wasn't laid out in detail. So that was sort of the main issue with this part of the letter, was just to explain the status of the CUPs and where we're at. I think the town council letter also just had some more general questions about the time frame and the next steps, which I think Kirk had covered in the previous items. So if there's questions about this letter, I'm happy to take those now, but of course, since some folks are just seeing it for the first time, you can follow up with me, and I've already contacted them.
I do have one question.
Sure.
If this doesn't go in our favor, and then you're going to get a hydrogeological report from us, how much time are you going to give us in 2019 to get that to you before you guys, say sorry with this UP? Because it is an expensive report, so.
Sure.
Even though you're extending it for a year to see what happens, if it doesn't go in our favor, what happens and how quickly are we going to have to submit that to you? Because a month isn't going to give us any time to do that. The prices are constantly going up and changing, so.
Sure, I think
we
we're willing to work with the water haulers if it comes back to we need the study again. I agree, like a month would not be.
And it takes, my understanding is the report itself is a 3 to 5 month period. It's not like, okay, you want it now, here you go. They have a lot that they have to do in order to prepare it. So, I mean, it does take time too. So
sure.
Keep that in mind.
Yeah, I think we'll work with you and negotiate a time frame that's reasonable. We're not going to hold off on this and then turn around and say, okay, now that the decision's been made, we need it in 30 days.
Okay.
That's not reasonable.
I expressed a little confusion to Kirk a little earlier before the meeting started about the sentence, however, the pending CUPs will not be scheduled for public hearings or any final actions until the hydrogeological study for the basin is completed and fully analyzed and until any other outstanding items are resolved. So the question in my mind is, the hydrogeological studies have to be done whether we're low priority or not.
At this point, that's our position, is that we do need a study for the CUPs to move forward. I think the question at this point is that if the state doesn't agree with the low priority, we may have to do the study as part of the GSA. So we don't want to duplicate efforts, is that if the GSA is going to have to do the study anyway, there's no point in asking the water haulers to do it. So that's what we're trying to get clarity on, is who eventually is going to have to
do the study. Is this a study that has to be done by each one of the water haulers and Water District 37?
No, if, let's say the state agrees and makes it a low priority basin, then the request would go back to the water haulers, which was her last question about the time frame. So since we're asking all three for the same study, I think we would like the three water haulers to combine their efforts and then get back to us in terms of what's a reasonable time frame for them to complete it, and then we could discuss
but
it and agree on
Water that. District 37 drawing from the same source?
Well, the conditional use permits are for the water haulers. So that's what we would be looking for, is for a study for what their potential impacts on the basin might be.
Well, I have a question, because the motivation for asking for the hydrogeologic study, is it CEQA based?
Right, that's correct.
CEQA only addresses when there are changes in the environment. And it's my understanding that none of these CUPs are asking for increased load. So there is no change to the environment. So therefore, CEQA does not attach. And I don't understand the justification for this. So perhaps maybe it's an offline discussion that I could have with Mr. Day or whoever, but I would like a clear understanding of the elements of either the CEQA statute or the CEQA guidelines that's driving this. If CEQA addresses a change in the environment and none of these applicants are seeking to change anything, none of these CUPs would result in a change in the environment. So it's my lameness. I don't see how CEQA's attaching. I understand it's a CUP with discretionary action, but because I think I misunderstood then what you said, it was my understanding of that meeting, but that's why I wrote this letter, because I want to make sure I understood that if it was reprioritized, the hydrogeologic study would not be required because we are not in a severe overdraft or even overdraft situation. So I had been, what you just said is not what I understood, and I apologize for misunderstanding. So if the expectation is this hydrogeologic study is going to be demanded, irrespective of what the state does, then I would like a better understanding of why that would be, since I do not see how CEQA, either statutorily or through the guidelines, attaches. I appreciate that.
I think if, in terms of a more in-depth explanation or justification for our position, I think that's reasonable. So it could either be a meeting, or if you want to send us another letter from the town council and have us respond however you want to proceed, but I think it's reasonable to ask this.
Okay, and maybe we'd better just have the water haulers do it.
I would like to be part of that, if you guys do go to that, I would like to be part of that meeting.
I don't know what the town council would do or think or say, but I'm here on behalf of SORT, so I'm not here on behalf of town council, but if I were on the town council, I would vote against us writing a letter without actually getting a request to do so from the water haulers themselves. So that's me speaking as a citizen, and what my perspective would be if I were asked on the town council. So,
so any other questions on the water haulers?
Yes, I just want to make sure I understand this. If you're saying that, in light of what Jackie said about CEQA, are you saying that there is other justification for demanding the water haulers to the hydrological study or not?
It is just for CEQA purposes. And the letter mentions that, is that as part of the environmental review, we're asking for the study to determine what the potential impacts of the water haulers are.
But if CEQA does not attach here, why would you need it?
Well, our position is CEQA does attach, but as I mentioned, if there's a desire for more in-depth discussion on that.
Why CEQA attaches?
Yes.
Well, CEQA always attaches, but there are categorical exemptions when you're not making a change to the environment, so it detaches and that will make it.
Okay, so you're just saying that there's other reasons under CEQA why it would attach.
Right.
Okay, I'm going to go study CEQA again.
I don't understand why this financial burden has to go on to the water haulers. Why? Isn't there another way to pay for these tests if they have to be done?
Well, when we always ask applicants to pay for studies. When the applicant comes in to do a development, we ask for them to conduct certain studies for under CEQA. So we're not treating the water hauling CUPs any differently.
But again, why wouldn't Water District 37 have to put up that money? They are out of the same basin as we are, and they draw from the same Santa Clara River. Why are they not having to put up the money? They make huge amounts more than we do.
Yes, they do.
I'm not ready to go out of business. I don't make any more money. You know, like, so why are we being the ones that have to put it up when Water District 37 is right there with us and they pull more than we do?
And they just don't have to have a
super. And on that note, like, I brought up the question at the previous meeting in November, because Mr. Msalvis mentioned how much water Waterworks pumps out. It was vastly more water than all three water haulers combined. And so I did pose the question that we did have to be forced to this hydro. And as Jackie had said too, we were kind of under the assumption that if the GSA was like abolished and we had the boundary modification went through, we would no longer need a geological assessment. But then in the case that we did have to get an assessment, I asked you personally if the Waterworks District 37 could at least help us pay for it, or at least be involved, because you guys said at least the three water haulers could come together for one geological assessment, but it doesn't seem fair that we'd have to take the burden on.
A letter from the county actually states, asks Waterworks 37 to contribute as well, and then they said, oh, we don't have to, but the county said they were included in it. So again, two different sides saying we don't have to, or they do, and we're stuck in the middle.
And if we want to talk about CEQA and the environmental impact, well, it's clear that Waterworks 37 has a vastly larger impact than the water haulers.
Well, as we discussed, we can have a more in-depth meeting, whether with just the water haulers or the town council involved, not involved. But again, we are putting that request on hold until this is resolved. But if this is resolved and we're still requesting it, then we can have those discussions as well. It's understood.
There's another thought. If this financially bankrupts one or two of the water haulers, the other one can't support both towns. It takes three water haulers to support Acton Agua Dulce. then what?
Well, again, we want to work collaboratively. I know that you made the point at the beginning of this meeting.
Yeah, this isn't fair. This isn't right.
Well, we want the water haulers to continue to operate. We just have the obligations under CEQA and our laws to follow the correct process. So we want to work collaboratively with the water haulers. The objective is not to run them out of business or cause any problems for people that are currently customers.
Just out of curiosity, this is a little way out, but is District 37 ready and able to serve more of the community than it currently solves if a couple of the water haulers call it in?
I don't know. That's a big question.
Well, it's something we're talking about, because it does turn out that way, which is what it doesn't, but it does. You can't leave all those people without water in their source.
Yeah, we're out of here. What are we going to do? We have to leave immediately.
Yeah, and who's going to buy your house?
Nobody's going to buy a house that has no water and can't get water to it, you know?
That's right.
We will lose everything.
I don't even want to think what we do to our schools.
Oh,
that's another story.
That's another story, yeah.
There's bigger implications here, Mitch, than
that's right.
Beyond.
That's 20, right.
20 gallons a day for a horse. You have four or five horses.
Yep.
You just can't get that water quick enough.
Yeah,
you'd be trucking every day to fill to carry your animals alone.
That's right.
That's a lot of water.
Yes. This town will dry up overnight. It's a very scary thought. And that's why ghost towns become ghost towns. You know? The reality of this is frightening.
Well, then the state wouldn't have any problems getting the high-speed rail through here.
That's true. Hey, go for it. Who cares? None of us will be here. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's the whole purpose of the sustainable groundwater. Make sure there's enough groundwater to sustain, the needs. So, that's the state has, these laws in place to, get local control over the water supply.
That's a real scary thing.
I get what you're saying, but I think you understand it.
What do you understand?
It's different if you live in the city and you pay a little extra to get your water to you than living on a well that's dried up and I really have no water when I turn on my faucet. And you have to wait for someone to bring you water, and we're booked up for a week, 2 weeks. It's a completely different thing than, I'll just pay a little extra fine for the water that I'm using because all I need is from the faucet. It's a completely different thing living in a city and having county water and all that than living in Acton, Alamosi, on a well that has no water. And you're literally living off of our schedule. Okay, I can fit you in today. Oh, sorry, it's completely different than, paying a little bit extra because you went over your monthly usage that you're supposed to.
Yep.
It is completely different.
Yeah.
Having someone from the city or the state managing how much water we can deliver to a house that does not produce water is completely different than managing, a city where it's add a fee to them. It's different.
Yeah.
And but the thing that's crazy about it is you guys are not the ones affecting the water table.
Not at all.
No,
that's we live on a river. It is not.
It would be different.
It's an underground river. It's not like we're draining just a little aquifer. It's the Santa Clara River.
No, but you're also not going down. Pillars.
Yeah. No, we're not.
If you were sustaining 40,000 people with your water haul, then that would be a different thing.
Yeah.
But I personally, if we lost 10% of our population, I don't think we have enough money to even cover the school bond at the high school. I mean, it's that. I go to the school board meetings, I know how tight your budget is. And so we need to sustain our population to sustain our what we have, and that's why certainly I'm involved in this effort. I like county water. I don't even have a well, but I know how important this issue is. So I appreciate you guys listening, but this
since this hydrology requirement and this CEQA concern I have is foundational for me at this point. So.
And these studies, we all went through these studies in the past to get our original CEQs in the first place. So, as she's mentioned, CEQA and any huge environmental changes that could possibly change the water tables. Nothing's happened since that time. And so, yeah, why do another study if it's not necessary? But if it is necessary, then, you know, like I am for, like, we want to make sure everything's okay. But as so far as we know, it doesn't seem like there has been any huge environmental changes that have CEQA involved. It seems like a requirement of the study.
Amber brought up a very good point. I've used all three water haulers for what she just said. I've called, they're booked solid, especially in the summertime. Things happen. We've had water lines break, drain the whole tank right down the driveway. We have no water. So I use all three of them in emergencies. Most of the time I use Amber, yeah. But there's been many times that I've used Lundy, I've used Carson, yeah, I've had to. You don't know how frightening it is to sit up here with no water. You can't brush your teeth, you can't flush your toilet, you can't take a shower. And God forbid if a fire comes through here, you don't have your reserve tanks to help the fire department to maybe save your house. See, we're all required to have storage tanks up here for fire in case of a fire comes through here because, you know, there are no fire hydrants where most of us live. So we rely on that. We have to keep those tanks full. And like I said, things happen. Water lines break. You get a little earthquake. It cracks the pipe. Boop, there goes your water. And you call. Can't be there. Middle of summer, we're booked. Okay. So I call the other two. Yeah, it's frightening. Very, very scary.
I just have a general question. I mean, I don't know too much about the water hauling and so forth, but what's the main reason to go to
When we first moved here 35 years ago, we had tons of water, no problem. But because of the drought, because of, excuse me, stupid city people that move up here who abused the water table and wasted the water, our water table went right down the toilet.
Well, the water table dropped.
It dropped. Seriously.
It went up. So.
Seriously dropped. Our well produces maybe 50 gallons a day. Okay, that's maybe two or three potty flushes. And it's seven times the safe limit of arsenic. We can't touch that water. Can't touch it. It's that contaminated now. We have no water.
For someone who, so at your house, if your toilet is running, it doesn't affect you. If someone's toilet is running in Acton, their tank will be drained within 2 days. No joke, they'll call, you just delivered a day ago. What happened to my water? You didn't bring it off. Well, is your toilet running? Oh, yeah. So a simple mistake in Acton costs them their entire tank. City, you don't even think about it. Oh, I have a drippy faucet. Oh, you know, it's not a huge priority to get that fixed. In Acton, that is huge that you have something leaking because water is like priceless. And it's
the primary reason, though, is supplemental to a well that has not done it. There are very few homes that have been permitted with no well. So I understand that the county thinks there are a lot. There are some. But my understanding,
most people dry up.
Predominantly, it's because over the last 15 years, the wells, water table has dropped.
I will never understand the mentality of people that come up here, build a swimming pool, and fill it full of well water. I will never understand people that come up here and plant acres and acres of grapevines and pump the water out of the well to water their plants. Or they're building a house, and when you build a house, you do the grading, you have to water that down. Instead of calling a water truck, they pump it out of the ground. My neighbor pumped 10,000 gallons out of the well every day to grade his damn property. And that's when our well went totally dry. And there was nothing we could do about it. Nothing, legally. The law is you've got a well on your property, you can do anything you want with it. We went up there and begged him to stop doing it. And I won't repeat what he said to us. He threw us all off his property. And that's the mentality of city people that move up here. They don't understand how valuable that water is. And we better protect it, because it's going bye-bye real quick.
Unfortunately, you're making the argument for them in favor of the GSA.
Oh.
Okay, so well, just so you're aware of the implications of your ultimate argument.
Yeah, well, I have to vent this off, you know, I really do. This is just ridiculous.
Thank you. I think that covers 2.4. 2.5, I know at the last board meeting with the GSA, it was resolution number 3 to pursue Prop 1 funding. So me and staff, we completed an application and submitted that to the state. And we have not heard back yet from the state, but from my understanding, there should be a lot of money to go around on the applications that were submitted. So if we do have to pursue a GSP, you know, a lot of GSAs will be getting money. And you know, if we have to go that route as East Acton at GSA, you know, hopefully there will be some money available, you know, in an event that we're required to prepare a GSP. So we don't have any information. There's no actual award for those monies yet. That's that fund.
When do you expect to hear?
I don't know. They said they would post in December, and now it's January.
So. Were there a lot of applications you did?
I think about 70 million, I think, for grabs for the projects and sustainability plans. So, you know, it seems at this point we're still in the running for, you know, potential funding in the Antelope Valley Basin. Because the money was allocated per Fulton 118 Basin, which is our basin. So that is something I would like to share with the group when I hear back. I feel that's like a worthy email. I don't want to bar people with you know, brief updates.
On this topic, we would like to be bothered.
Yeah, but I feel like, you know, like that's one key bit of information that, you know, is worth sharing. And I submitted the application on time, November 13th, and it was accepted by the state. So that's the current status of that, and I will report back. Email when I hear what the state side to do with that one. So that covers part 2 of the agenda. Part 3 is future agenda items. And I know we don't want to pursue a water sustainability plan, but you do have to submit a notice to the state when you, you know, the state will be requesting GSAs to submit a notice in preparation of a GSP. But I think given our situation, that the state will, you know, provide, you know, time to figure out whether the basin boundary will be granted and priority will be assessed. But at some point, the state will need to hear from the GSA, the intentions to prepare that GSP.
Is there a deadline for that?
I don't know what the deadline is. I know that the GSP needs to be in place by year 2022, so this is further out. But
because we're very high risk, right? So that's the timeframe is driven because we're very high.
We're high.
But that's a driving the 2022. How long would it take to draw the plan out? You haven't put an RFP out, though.
No. At this point, we're pursuing the basin boundary modifications, basin reassessment, and if it looks like it's not going in our favor, and we're awarded the grant funds, you know, that funding would be, you know, put towards GSP. And then GSP, you know, it's basically going to monitor groundwater for a period of time. And, you know, the state, they just want the groundwater to be managed in the long run. They have a 40-year outlook. They want all basins in California to be managed sustainably. They don't want any adverse effects. I think in the initial meeting back in April 2017, the state kind of presented on, you know, the reason why you have a GSP is to, you know, make sure there's no unintended consequences of, you know, overuse. So that's just where things may end up, you know, in the future. But, you know, the state will require a notice, and that notice won't be submitted until the ordinance or at the meeting and provide
authorization. Oh, the GSA board.
Yes, so that's why I'm bringing up that's a future agenda item for this group. So before it is presented to the board, that this group should have a review of, you know, what's expected at the at that board meeting and we're to provide a notice for GSP development.
I understand. However, I don't even want to go to that vote until we know we have to. And it's a struggle for me to understand that it would take more than a year to draw this plan up. So, and if you actually would hire an outside consultant to do it, your RFP process, I don't know, 6 months. So, I mean, I'm struggling to see that you would need to even issue a notice in terms of time before the end of 2019, maybe mid-2019. So I guess I would encourage you to not put this as a board agenda item until we know we really need to. If you could back calculate what your time estimate is to do a plan, because I cannot, if your contractor takes more than a year to draw the plan, then you didn't pick the right contractor, because it's not a big basin, not a lot of users. And hopefully other basins will have already done their plan and the model sort of set. First guy out of the gate is going to be the one that's going to take the longest and do the lamest job because they're literally the first. But at any rate, so I would encourage you this not to be an issue that's voted on, the notice for some time and not the next meeting.
All right, this is a heads up. Just, you know, okay. I'm not saying it's 2 years. I'm saying this is one of the next notices that the DFR requires, you know, for GSP development. So I'll report back to the group of the timeline and when the state is expecting those notices to come through.
How many consultants have contacted you, roughly?
3, 4, or 5. Some of them specialize in some aspect of, you know, hydrogeology, groundwater management. You know, some don't know what funding is available, so consultants out there that are, you know, looking at, you know, helping agencies, you know, manage that groundwater through, you know, GSP development. So,
I have a question. Maybe this is not the right place, but I'm just curious as to whether or not the county has any long, but I just can't believe that they don't have a long-range plan regarding growth and water usage in this area. The whole North LA County area. I mean, they're planning for everything else. Doesn't the county look far into the future? Just like the general plan and the AV plan is that we need a plan for. But what about water?
Well, I think that for when we did the updates of the environmental impact reports for the Santa Cruz Valley plan update and the Antelope Valley area plan update, since there were unadjudicated basins, those EIRs concluded we didn't know that there was enough water to support development. So we had to disclose that we don't know if there's enough water to support the build out. But that's one of the reasons why in both the Santa Cruz Valley and the Antelope Valley, we reduced the growth substantially and reduced the number of houses that could be built in rural areas, including Agua Dulce and Acton and other parts of the Antelope Valley as well.
So there is a concerted effort to control growth here beyond what the CSBs dictate.
Well, as part, again, and with Town and Country, we worked very closely with the communities and the town councils. And part of the reason we decided to reduce the growth numbers was not only uncertainty over water supplies, but there's also a lot of other hazards that we considered, like the high fire zones, seismic issues, landslide and liquefaction zones, and then also environmental resources like the significant ecological areas. And we know there was a lot of discussion in this area and other areas. So there were a lot of reasons we thought it made sense to reduce the build out in these communities. But it was a long process involving the communities and the town councils. I know many of you participated in those.
That's why, most of the land is now 10 acre or 20 acre or 40 acre.
I know, all that was done. It just seems that a lot of people who own property here have been, what shall I say, compromised by what the county is doing. That's a whole other story, not to go into here. But it's interesting, it's the first time I've actually heard someone from the county say what you're saying, which is interesting. But thank you that you're saying so.
Sure.
We have a developer that's approached the town council recently. He's interested in resurrecting a past project that was proposed for just north on Crown Valley here. And it's a large, it's Sycam Engineering, so it's a large outfit. Yeah, we're very concerned about the runoff drainage potential there for destroying the Crown Meadows neighborhood that lies just south of it. And the past project had undersized lots, it was 30 plus homes. How does regional planning feel about a development like that if you're trying to keep a lid on things?
Sure, well, I'm going to assume, I don't know the details of the project, but I'm going to assume that the previous approval, it either never got there.
It expired.
Or it expired. So if it expired and they decide to reapply, then they're going to have to meet all of today's standards. So they don't have any grandfathering. So they're going to have to comply with the current area plan designation, which could be RL5 or RL10, like Jackie mentioned, RL20 even in some areas. And then any other drainage requirements from public works. We have low-impact development, which we didn't have until about 10 years ago. So any development that comes in is going to have to meet all of the county rules and comply with all the current policies. And it would also, of course, have to go through CEQA and any studies to look at some of the impacts you mentioned or other impacts that we'd be concerned about.
Yeah, they haven't come forward with proposal for a current project. All they did was submit an expired project and say, this is kind of what we were thinking. And that was expired, 11 years ago. I think it was, wasn't it 2007, Jackie, that project was expired?
No, I think the tentative map was approved in
2000.
It was modified in 2004, 5, and 6, but then the map that kept getting rescinded. So I think it just expired just a few years ago. Because of the downturn in the economy, the state legislature kept extending the map back.
Anyway, so we're facing that, and in your future, if they're to come make their proposal, but Public Works is going to come and participate in that discussion.
As far as future agenda items, if anyone thinks of a future agenda item that they want to have addressed potentially at the next advisory committee, yeah, we can provide that update. So anybody has any other public comments at this time? Okay, I guess we can adjourn the meeting.
Thank you very much for coming up.
4:26.
I appreciate it.
Good work.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
34 minutes early.